Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the Options Animal Weekly. This is Greg. Glad to be with you on this beautiful Friday afternoon. Jeff, glad to have you with us.
Thanks, Greg. Happy to be here. Happy to be here.
Eric, as always.
Booyah!
And Bill, I will apologize for Jeff not getting copyright privileges on your photo there. Again, I'm using your words, not mine. Glad to have you here today as well. As always, glad to have you all here. Before we get into talking about the market, I need to remind everyone the information in today's broadcast is for educational and illustrative purposes only. It's no way a recommendation to buy or sell any security, nor any options derivative thereof, nor should be considered any type of investment advice. Remember that the options market does involve risk, and you should have a firm understanding of the rights, risks, and obligations associated with your options trading instrument before considering placing any type of trade. So the markets are sitting at three-month highs, having a phenomenal reaction today to, well, several things, and I'm sure we'll talk about a few of them. But the big news, of course, was our jobs report, and we'll spend a little bit of time talking about that as well. I wanted to point out the annual move where we're sitting. We, the S&P is up about 10% year to date. Again, this week we ended up squeaking back to the positive barely. We really had a lot of up and down and down and back up, and quite honestly, an enormous amount of news this week. I have a feeling we're going to have a hard time covering everything that happened this week. And let's just jump into it. Early in the week, it was all about, it wasn't all about Europe, but it was mostly about Europe. It was mostly about the idea that, we had coming off two really big days on Thursday and Friday of last week after Mario Draghi came out and said the ECB were going to stand behind whatever we need to do to make this work, and we're going to make sure that the euro stays alive. Still no concrete plan, in my view, that has come out. And then, as you can see there, the finger pointing and the little tiny harp playing started. I'm assuming that's what Angela Merkel's doing there, is playing a little tiny harp.
It's a violin.
Little tiny violin. For all the people whining about Greek two-year yields at 109% or wherever they're at right now. Yeah, it was more of the same, I guess, in my view. And I'll open it up to you guys before we move on to some of the other stuff to tell me about your feelings on this confrontation still going on in Europe. And my view was, is it's just more talk. We got promises, and the market rallied on at the end of the last week. And then the start of this week, we started to realize, it's all good dandy, but until Germany decides they're going to participate, it's not going to happen. Jeff, what do you think?
Well, talk is cheap. Draghi did a nice job of puffing up his chest last week, standing up at the microphone, Mr. Microphone, and reassuring the world that he'll do whatever it takes. And then, of course, along comes Germany and says, no, you won't. Because we're not ready to play that game. And I can see Germany's point that they don't really want to shoulder the debt of everybody else, raise their it's kind of like there's a limited amount of resources and they're being allocated the way that they are at this point. But the plans that are being discussed so far do nothing more than bring Germany's debt up while lowering other countries' debt down to try to sort of level the playing field a little bit, which gives the other countries a little more breathing room, but Germany ends up paying for it. So, you can see why they're saying this isn't a good plan. In the long run, this isn't the answer. And I don't know whether they're going to come up with an answer. I don't know. They're really against the ECB print, print, print. And they're really against the buying of the bonds of the different countries, because it's just, you know, Germany's going to have to back it. So I'm not surprised. I was a little disappointed, and that was most of the commentators said yesterday, is they were a little surprised. I mean, they didn't even cut interest rates, which they could have. They could have cut the rates just a little bit, and they didn't even do that. So, you know, all of a sudden, Draghi becomes just another mouth. And I think going forward, unless he comes out with concrete plans, he's just lost a little bit of credibility. You know, the world had great hopes that there was some sort of plan, and then it became obvious on Thursday. Yeah, no, we don't have a plan. Eric?
Yeah, that's it. We didn't really learn anything this week. So, I mean, it was just words, all words. And so, you know, last week, the phrase that he used when you guys were, I guess you were in Chicago, yeah, in my hometown, and I didn't even see you. But, hey, you know, besides the point, I hope you guys had fun at that event. No, last week on the show, I mean, we talked about, you know, the words that he used are very powerful. You know, whatever it takes, he'll do whatever it takes to save the euro. So very powerful words, put a lot of confidence in there. We just got no, you know, it was just words. There's, you know, there's nothing behind it. So, yeah, I don't think anything's really changed in Europe, and we're still really nervous. I guess that we talked last week about I guess Spanish bonds, which have come down a little bit. I don't watch it too closely myself. I listen into the news, and I guess that would indicate that there's some level of comfort. But like you said, yeah, Thursday certainly, you know, Draghi's words, the market reacted instantaneously, and we saw a precipitous drop. And I guess like you said, I'm just going to agree with you and said we just didn't learn anything. I mean, there is no plan. It's just words. So that's all I have to say.
6.848 was the closing 10-year. Spanish bond.
Hey, it's under 7. It's sustainable, right?
Yeah, if you don't want to have money for anything else.
We can at least pay interest.
Yeah.
It's obviously a concern that has not gone away. And later in the week, as the week progressed, I know we heard about Europe Monday really through Thursday. It was really the story the first part of the week for the most part. But then we also had our own central bank and the situation developing there. I shouldn't say developing. I should say just continuing. And how sorry. Jeff, I think that's one of the first times you've made me absolutely break out laughing.
You see all eyes on me? Can you read that?
Mickey superimposed on, I think that's Tupac. I'm not sure, but okay.
It might be 50 cents.
It might be 50 cents. Now, back to our Federal Reserve. And really they came out and said things are still pretty bad. And in fact, we don't see them getting better, was the message that I got from the Federal Reserve. We don't see them getting better until 2014. We expect to see, again, I'm saying that, I'm putting words in their mouth. They didn't come straight out and say that. What they said is that they expect to see 0 to 0.25% interest rates until the end of 2014. That tells me that there's a lot of things they're looking at that have them concerned. And whether it's because they're focused on Europe and are oversensitive to the situations that are going on there, whether they're looking at our, you know, all of the factors we are facing here in our own domestic economy, from our fiscal cliff to our enormous amount of debt we've got hanging over our heads. You know, again, we've got $12 trillion of publicly traded debt that can change really quickly. You guys know what the 2 years ago, I actually heard this stat, or, you know, quoted earlier today, or maybe it was yesterday. I don't remember where I heard it. 2 years ago, do you know what the Greek 2-year bond was trading at?
No idea.
The 1.9%. That was the pretty close to what our bonds are trading at. You know, again, a little higher. You can't get 1.9 for a 2-year. That's about what our 10-year, actually even more than what our 10-year is yielding right now. But 1.9%, 2 years later, it's over 100%. That's how quickly things can change with the enormous amount of debt. So maybe that's what the Fed is still looking at, concerned. Our unemployment rate, we'll talk about employment here in a minute, because of course that's one of the major reasons why the market rallied today, was the better than expected employment data that we got. But the Federal Reserve was I think another downer on the market this week, in that they said, look, things are bad, they're slowly progressing, but don't worry, we're going to pull the trigger on QE3 if we need to, and when we decide we need to.
I don't think
that did a lot of things to reassure the market. Sorry, go ahead, Jeff.
Well, I was just going to say, and I mentioned this on Monday in my chat to a smaller audience, I think a lot of the problem, you guys, is that with all of the economies of the world really, really slowing down, most of Europe's already in recession. We probably won't, but there's a possibility, but there's not really much growth. Third world, not much growth. China slowing down. It gets to a point where all of these countries that are in recessions are going to need to try to do something to increase their gross domestic product. But the problem is since the world's gross domestic product is not growing, it's as if you have different baskets of apples or whatever you want, Rim, anyway. And what they're going to do is they're going to put stimulus into the country to try to drive down the cost of their own goods to increase the demand. But that demand has to come at the expense of somebody else's GDP. And so then you're going to see that other country, whether it's us or somebody else, start to take some sort of stimulative measures as well, until we find a way to really stimulate the entire world's economy. That's kind of what I think they're seeing. That's a lot of what they're seeing. You can't increase GDP when everybody's economy is stuck in neutral, and it just sort of becomes shifting things around, and that's really bad, because if we start doing that, we can really get into a deflationary environment. So I'm not sure what the way out of this is, but I think that has a lot to do with it.
Yeah, the Fed statement, the timing of the release of the Fed statement, and there was a precipitous drop and the minute that it came out, and so the market didn't like it. There wasn't that much different from what the Fed has normally said, other than they're going to keep rates at exceptionally low through 2014 now. I think that was the change. That should have been a good thing, and that Operation Twist is going to continue. The words that I did see added, and I mean, we're explicitly, I think the words were, strains in global financial markets continue to pose significant downside risks to the economic outlook, and I think that was, you know, throwing in what's happening in Asia and Europe. And those have sort of been hinted at, but it was, I think it was stated a little more strongly in this statement. So I honestly don't think, I think maybe some people were expecting a QE3 or something. I think that's probably why the market reacted negatively, but I think if that's going to happen, it's probably going to hear about it in Jackson Hole, which is in a few weeks.
That's my guess as well. If we hear that something's going to happen in September, I don't think it'll happen in September, because I don't think that Mr. Bernanke is going to come out with any type of action before the election. I don't think we will see Fed action until December with any type of new quantitative easing. I believe it's a political time bomb or a political hand grenade, whatever you want to call it, if you did that initially. The downside of that is it, and again, I'm not an advocate saying that it's needed, because I'm in the camp that thinks that we've done too much quantitative easing and that we need to experience a little bit of pain to really fix things and to get on the path of really fixing things. But that doesn't mean the market wants that. You know, the market wants their morphine. The market wants this QE, and for the market to continue higher,
yes, for the market to trend higher.
He's anticipation. He's making us wait.
It's a dramatic pause there, Greg. We lost you there. In order for the market to trend
20
higher.
20 seconds.
That's. Are you? Am I back?
Yeah, you said, in order for the market to trend higher, and then it was just a long pause.
Yeah, we thought it was really a dramatic pause, but
for the market to trend higher,
you lost.
Did it work again that time?
Yeah.
No.
Dang it. Okay, so for the market to trend higher, the QE, it's wanted QE. I mean, it wants continued QE. Again, it wants its morphine. I don't think we'll get it. I don't think we need it. And in the long term, like I said, I think we need to go through some pain as an economy. But, I think it's a political hand grenade that they're not willing to do before December. What do you think?
What could it be after the election, but before December? I just don't want to get to the cliff and look over the edge and see that there's no bottom there.
I don't think we're going to get that done either. I'll be honest. I don't think we are. I'm just saying. I think we've got an interesting few months coming up in front of us. Do you really think a lame duck Congress is going to get a fiscal cliff taken care of?
Negative.
And will they do it before the election? It's just a really interesting set of circumstances we find ourselves in, with, again, politicians looking at their political careers versus arguably doing what's right for the country and for the economy. They're more worried about getting reelected, I believe, than they are actually fixing something. So, I don't know. We'll see. I think that what it tells me is we're going to have more of this up and down. What I do like from an investor standpoint and looking at the market is the market is clearly painting a higher trend. You can see that right there on that chart of the Dow, that we've got a series of higher highs and higher lows. And if this, in fact, the bounce today, and let's get to what the bounce today here in just a minute, but I want to look at the chart just for a minute before we go on there. If this proves to be yet another bottom and we go back up to 13.3 or 13.4 now on the Dow before we hit a little bit of resistance, it's a nice uptrend we've got going. And, you know, again, we can argue the big picture what-ifs all you want, but the tape is clearly still higher right now, and I think that's the way you got to be trading it. Is to be able to take advantage of this bullish move.
Yeah, higher highs, higher lows. Any positions, just collared, just hedged, just in case.
So what did move the market higher then this week? Well, again, most of it all came today, and it was housing.
Jobs.
Let's talk about this. I want to come back to that.
You said housing.
I know. Well, sorry, I did say housing, didn't I? I meant jobs. It's because he went through that slide and I wanted to talk about. But we'll talk about the night trading debacle here in just a minute. The jobs report. Of course, the big event today, we got a much bigger than expected report, or much better than expected report, of 156,000. No, that's the civilian labor force. 163,000 jobs added in the month of July. Again, expectations were somewhere between, I'd heard numbers as low as 75,000. The general consensus was right around 100,000 was the expectation, and we came in at 163. Clearly, more jobs added than expected. That's what the market wanted grasped onto today, and we rallied. And we actually had a very strong rally, and it was across the board. I mean, again, it was multiple different industries, from financials to technologies to cyclicals. Big day today. So let me ask you this question, because I know it's been debated all day long. Is it big enough? Is it good enough to justify the type of move we have and justify being able to take a bullish stance in the market? Jeff?
Nope. Eric?
Okay.
You're wrong! No. I mean, the number was within range. And honestly, I don't think the number was that good that it made the market rally as much as it did. I mean, oftentimes we struggle and look for reasons why things went up. And I'm telling you that it didn't feel right. You know, it didn't feel like, I mean, unemployment's up to 8.3. Hey, that's not a good thing. The unemployment rate went up. And we know there's some things behind that, but it's not a great situation, and the market did respond. I was fighting, you know, looking for it. Just didn't feel right to me. And actually, I was listening to Bloomberg today, and they had a guy on. I was trying to find the quote before the show, and I couldn't. And if anybody heard this, you know, let me know if you agree. But he was saying that there's something else that happened overnight that most retail traders aren't privy to, and that is that the Fed added significantly to its balance sheet, and something with the Japan Aussie dollar, which I don't really understand, which is why I was trying to read it. I did do some research and found that the Fed has dramatically increased its balance sheet over the past week, and that makes liquidity. It makes it easier to trade, which helps put some confidence into the market. And so, if anybody else has seen that, I'd like to get what the reference is. But like I said, I didn't feel like the jobs numbers were. I mean, I was looking through it. I thought it was good, but not great. Not enough to make the market go up 2% today. I mean, it just didn't feel right to me.
You know, so this time last year, you know, when we were in San Francisco, I mean, this is exactly when it was last year. The jobs report came out, and it was like 250,000 jobs. You know, it was a big spike up, and just because the number comes up, I mean, I'm glad these numbers are coming up, but we're not all clear. I mean, it's not safe for everybody to jump up and get uber bullish. It's not deteriorating, although they did revise last month's numbers down a little bit. I mean, you know, it's good. It's definitely better than what was expected, and that's a good thing. It's a step in the right direction, but it's a process, and it's going to take time, and you just don't turn a switch and say, okay, well, everything's, you know, all bullish now because of this. And I think you're right, Eric. I was kind of surprised that the reaction to these numbers, which are okay, pretty good, but the rest of the economic numbers this week were nothing to write home about. Some of them were okay, but there was nothing really to get all that excited about. So it didn't really seem appropriate. So I suspect that you're right, because Europe was already up. The futures were up nicely before these numbers even came out. Greg?
Well, I agree with both of you. And that's why I wanted to get your opinion first. I don't think the employment number was that good. In fact, one of the things I like that I'm starting to see more of the mainstream media start to report on is a report or a number called the U6, which doesn't just include the people who are unemployed and who are actually looking for work. It includes the labor force that's not working, whether it's because they have stopped looking for work because they're discouraged, whether it's because they are just working part-time to try to get by, so they want a full-time job, but there aren't any available, and that number is actually still significantly high, and in fact, in some places, still growing. The national average on that number that I saw was 14.9%, but in some places, Nevada is still over 22%, California, 20.3%. There are actually only three states in the country that have under a 10% U6.
Who are they?
What do you think? Let's have you guys guess.
One could be New Hampshire.
It's not New Hampshire.
No.
Let me put it this way. I believe it's the place that's showing us the solution to our employment problem. Joan got it. Joanne got it. One of them.
North Dakota?
North Dakota.
There are only four people who live there.
South Dakota and Nebraska.
It's oil.
It's energy. Energy is the number one solution, in my opinion, to fix our employment problem. It was one of the conversations we had at the Invest Like a Monster conference last weekend was, you know, one of the biggest solutions to our employment problem is to become energy independent and stop spending so much money on overseas oil and find ways and resources to tap the oil reserves that we do have here. So, and Bill, no, not ruin the ecology in the process. I agree with you. There has to be balance, but there is a way. It just has to be found. And that, I believe, is the solution to, you know, much of our points to help increase our unemployment problem is, you know, focus on those oils that we have and those energies that we have the ability to go get. Okay, because the reality is our unemployment level has been above 8% for 42 straight months now. And that is the longest stretch in the history of our country that our employment level has been above 8%. And I think Ben Bernanke's trying to do everything he can without absolutely flooding the market with a massive bomb that's going to go off in the future with too much liquidity. I know that's what scares a lot of people about more QE, is the continued damaging effects that it could have long term for the economy. But one of their mandates, again, as an organization, the Federal Reserve, one of their mandates is to try to help employment. And so that's what they're supposed to try and do. I know it's one of those situations that make you as an individual investor still have to say, I am, even though the trend is clearly bullish, even though we had a nice bullish feeling rally today, I still have to be cautious right now. I still have to trade cautiously, because you're right, Jeff. I remember that a year ago. We had a similar type of good feeling employment report, and we had a nice little market rally, and then 2 weeks later, we got downgraded as a country.
No, we got downgraded on that Friday. It was the same day.
Was it just a week? Was it that same day?
It was the same. Yeah, it was. It was the same day. I unfortunately, that was a really traumatic day for me personally.
Remember, Najarian was there, right?
Yep.
He got a phone call from somebody on.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
The night before, he told us ahead of time.
Yep. Here's the thing Rick Santelli was referring to with the energy that you were talking about becoming self-sufficient, and GE was going to create the storage tank. Remember Rick talking about that?
Right. Right.
Home fueling station that could sell for $500. So everybody could fuel their cars without going to gas stations.
That's good. Of course, the oil companies and the car companies wouldn't like that.
No, they won't. But
because those engines require a lot less maintenance.
A lot less maintenance. They burn a lot cleaner fuel. Doesn't do the long-term damaging effect on the.
It's bad for. It's better for the environment. No way.
It's much better for the environment.
Never gonna happen.
We'll see. I'm not gonna jump out and buy puts on ExxonMobil just yet. Just so you know, they've got a pretty strong arm in Congress.
Yeah.
All right. We talked about the Fed. We talked about. I know what else I wanted to talk about last week, because I think this is impacting the markets. Long term, it is, and we had another debacle this week. Now, it didn't impact a lot of traders, at least you and I type of traders, you know, retail guys. It did crush Knight. They had a computer glitch, and it caused some extremely high levels of trading. They ended up losing a lot of money. I actually heard today that Knight is seeking funding right now, that they very likely could end up going under because of it. I mean, you start to rattle off the different things that have rattled the individual investor's confidence in the system and whether it's fair, from the flash crash a couple of years ago to the BATS. You remember when BATS went public with their own system, and that debacle, the Facebook debacle that was really, as much as anything, part of it was just the hype around Facebook. Part of it was the computer problems when they initiated the IPO.
J.P. Morgan's risk?
Yeah, J.P. Morgan's
Goldman risk. Goldman Sachs whale, right? I mean, it's been all over the place.
Yeah, it just keeps – these type of events, again, most of it doesn't impact us. I think the biggest one of all of those that impacted us as individual investors could have been the flash crash if you panicked out midday, or if you were using stop losses as your means of protection.
There's some investigation on this Knight Capital thing, because a lot of brokers, and I don't know if mine do, but a lot of brokers do route trades through them, and apparently there were 148 components of the S&P 500 that did that were affected by this. And I think Goodyear is the one that symbol GT, Goodyear. If you go and you look and look at like a 5-minute chart and take a look and see what happened earlier this week, you can see that it opened really, really low, and they believe that was Knight Capital, Molly Corp, Alcoa, just a few that I looked at, and you definitely could see an open at the day. So yeah, go to a 5-minute chart And you'll
well,
see.
I can't go to 5 minute because of the time frame. What ticker symbol do you want?
GT, Golf Tango.
Where was it? On Wednesday?
Yeah. I guess, see, that open, there was a huge move up, and then it opened down pretty dramatically there. Yeah, that right there, the move was, I guess, due to, or I guess the investigation is, so they're talking about maybe going back and breaking some of those trades, but there's only so much they can do.
Here's a better one, Exelon.
Okay. Yeah, and there's 148 of them that are out there that got slammed due to this like capital thing. It's just unbelievable that, you
know, there it
that
is.
Sort of stuff can happen. I mean, yeah, there it is. That's that trading was the result of Knight Capital's FUBAR. Those guys lost $440 million. You talk about having a bad day. That's one-third of their annual revenue they lost. One-third of their annual revenue they lost in a day. Their implied volatility, by the way, is up to 250% right now. So,
gee, I wonder why.
So some people did get stuck. No, I'm not going to touch it.
You're not going to go sell it?
But I'm gonna tell you what, you know, if you were in a collar trade, you would have been fine. You know, we don't always stay in collar trades, and you can't tell when this sort of thing was happening. Flash crash, you know, we couldn't have told when that was gonna happen ahead of time, or the bots did a buckle or something else. But for those people that are, you know, more conservative, long-term traders, and they're comfortable being in these long-term, I mean, think about, you know, everybody's talking about dividends, you know, being in a dividend-paying stock, put it in a collar trade, right? You lock the thing up. Yeah, you don't make a lot of money from the stock going up, but you don't lose any money either. And this kind of stuff happens, you're protected, and you got a dividend. I mean, where can you get, you know, there's stocks out there, solid companies that are paying 3% or more dividends. I mean, there's people that, you know, that need that sort of investment, and that's what we teach how to do. And that's just one style.
And that's one of the points I kind of wanted to make with this, Eric, was that, you know, the confidence and the fear that has been struck into the individual investor who doesn't understand how to use trades like the collar trade or how to use options to protect their positions is just left to trusting that these guys who run these quant trading black box systems are going to protect this market. And that's why you're seeing fewer and fewer. You're seeing the retail investor do one of two things. Either they're leaving the market in droves and going to the bond market because they don't trust the stock market anymore, or they're getting educated in how to protect themselves in the use of options because you just can't trust it anymore. So it's something that was interesting. I don't know if you saw it, if you watched, I think it was on the halftime show today. I don't remember, on CNBC. I don't know if any of you guys followed Doug Cass. He's an interesting guy. Very outspoken man, Doug Cass is. But he made some pretty, again, outspoken, bold comments today that we need to get rid of black box trading. Who cares about the liquidity they provide? They're going to kill us all. And we need to kill them before they kill us, was ultimately his commentary. And I don't know that I necessarily disagree with him on that. I think a lot of the computer-driven trading is really not in the best interest of the individual investor who's trading in this. And if you think about it, if you go back to the core of what the market is, and I think this argues at the heart of who J.P. Morgan is and Goldman Sachs and all these big banks and these big trading machines that have been created over the last 20 years, that's really not what the stock market is. If you go back to its roots, the stock market is about you and I, individuals making investments based on our belief and our due diligence as to where we think the market is, or we think a company is going. And when you have someone coming in with a sophisticated computerized model that potentially creates a scenario that makes it unfair for you and I to invest in Apple or invest in whoever that we want it to be, it's not fair anymore. And that's the argument that I believe is it's starting to gain some traction. So as much as I love the liquidity there, I'd arguably maybe give up the liquidity and mean that my may have to go back away from $1 strikes and penny bid ask spreads and go back to, you know, quarters and eighths and teenies and halves and trade. And for those of you who don't know what a teeny is, by the way, I'm using an old term there. A teeny is a 16th. That's how options and actually stocks used to be traded as well, but they call the 16th teeny. Anyway, sorry, I'm ranting. No, I'll leave it alone. I think I'm beating this horse dead. I'm tired of the high frequency trading guys. Fortunately, I know how to use options and I can hedge the risk. All right. Anything else last week you want to talk about? We spent a lot of time on last week.
Negative.
I thought LinkedIn's earnings were pretty good. And it's the only company that a very interesting concept for some of these tech companies, these internet companies, call it a thing called, I forget how you pronounce it, it's a revenue or something like that. Have you heard of that? So, yeah, LinkedIn did pretty well with good numbers. I thought that was impressive.
I actually had some data up here for us, speaking of numbers, just sort of an update, that the numbers have been coming in okay. Not great, but what's disconcerting is that everybody's guiding lower. And as you can see from the table above, we're driving down the expectations for Q2 this year and for 2012 right across the board. So this was, or is shaping up to be, the best quarter ever, believe it or not. The one that we're in right now, even though everybody's guiding lower, we're still, you know, the numbers are coming in okay. What concerns me is the revenue numbers, as we talked about. That was 2 weeks ago we talked about that when we were out in Chicago at the Blackstone, that awesome, awesome ballroom. Is this thing still on? You guys still there?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Greg?
All right, let's move on to next week. There's a handful of events next week as well that you'll need to pay attention to. I'll be paying attention to. We do have a continuation of earnings. We have a handful of earnings that are still out. We do have economic data out next week as well, though not nearly as much as we had this week. Again, you can see there we've got consumer credit. Wow, really nothing.
Nothing. Note.
Nope. Initial claims is the biggest report next week. So economic events will be pretty quiet, which means it's very likely, because the earnings events honestly are going to be pretty quiet as well, we're probably looking across the ocean and not just at the Olympics this week either. Though how about Michael Phelps? I know everyone was writing him off after his first event he did with the medley that he ended up not even placing. He got fourth. Is he the best Olympian ever?
Yeah, he's got the most medals. I couldn't stay up that late. How did he do last night?
Continues to do phenomenal. Won the 100-meter butterfly.
Wow.
I just wonder if they'll talk him into going to the next one. I know he said he's retiring. We'll see. All right.
I'm watching Rio Tinto next week. Rio Tinto's earnings will be interesting, and then I got a stock to watch that I'm also watching. But Rio's, you know, sometimes gives some insight into commodities and where things are being used. So it could be in. I think that kind of that's one on its reports on the 8th before the market opens. So that's Wednesday morning. So I could potentially move the market. We'll see what happens there.
I don't know if you just saw the after hours earnings report
of Berkey Bees
from Berkshire. Berkshire just beat earnings pretty handily, actually. Again, I don't necessarily I don't trade Berkshire. I mean, what did they have volume? 100? I think 700 shares traded today on the A shares. 717 to be exact, shares traded today. But I like to look at Berkshire from a standpoint of kind of what you were insinuating. You would look at a company like Rio Tinto as as a view of how commodities are being used resource-wise. I like to look at Berkshire almost as arguably just a snapshot of the entire economy. They've got such a broad diversity, and yeah, Berkshire's having a little after-hours move. The B shares are, huh?
It's a little party over there at the Berkshire headquarters.
break out the seven up and licorice, right?
Exactly. And the ice cream. And the ice cream.
And the, oh, that's right. He does like ice cream too.
Yeah, Warren Buffett's out there doing the Cabbage Patch. Got a visual on that?
No.
He loves Dilly Buyers.
All righty. Anything else next week that you guys are looking at?
No, it's all overseas.
It's fight week.
Yep. Could be. Oh, what? Now we've said it. Something will come out of nowhere.
No. You said quiet. No, you meant quiet because the economic numbers.
Did that doing good on Jinx?
I'll make a prediction. I think Monday's going to be down. I think the VIX is going to spike on Monday. That's my prediction.
Wow. Okay.
All right. We'll see. All right. As far as announcements go, not a lot to announce. We do have, again, as always, the Hawaii Summit. Start booking your rooms now, December 3rd through 7th. Get on the list. Always fun events.
There were some people looking for roommates, by the way. I think I saw a woman post in the forums looking for a roommate, which is
good. You did. Yep.
My wife is opposed to me rooming with her, but, maybe yours. Kidding. Oh, that was weird. That was awkward. Okay, never mind.
We do have a trader workshop this month as well. It's in a couple weeks, August 25th. So for those of you in the trader program, put that on your calendar. It's going to be this month. It's going to be Karen and Ken. Okay. Anything else announcement-wise?
Nope.
I don't think so. Quiet week here, too. Okay. Let's talk about our stocks this week. Maybe we can find something that will actually move on our equities.
Oh, I did have one announcement.
Oh,
right. This one up, if anybody wants to, it helps Options Animal, our credibility. If you guys go to the site, tweet the site, or whatever, we write these sort of things. Greg writes most of them. Occasionally I go up too, but it helps Options Animal. So if you don't mind, you want to go look at it. You already know what I think about Green Mountain Coffee Roasters. I've already had a nasty post back against it, but hey, so be it.
All righty.
Cisco. Cisco was a stock to watch for me last week. Interesting move up. Yeah, so I'm still keeping an eye on it. I'm not getting into it. Earnings are coming up on the 15th, so I talked about potentially doing a double diagonal this week, which I didn't get into. But Cisco is a fun one to watch, and I'm just I'm expecting – had a big move down based on some news about acquisition, so it'll be interesting to see what happens there. Business is changing, I think. It'll be interesting to see what happens on earnings in a couple weeks. So Cisco, Charlie Oscar is on my watch list for this week for just an interesting movement based on the behavior of what I've seen, so watching it.
You know how they have FedWatch?
Yes.
And it used to be more –
Yes.
Okay. Well, they have Cisco Watch now to see whether or not it looks like John Chambers is carrying a gun as he goes into the thing to shoot his foot again.
He's on suicide. Oh, that's good. I see. See if he shoots himself in the foot. Yeah, I think that is one big earnings that I'm going to keep an eye on. It'd be fun to watch and see what happens. So, not sure how you trade it. If I was in Cisco, I'd definitely be in a caller though. I'll tell you that. So, but I'm going to watch it. We'll see what happens. Next one for me, stock to watch, is NVIDIA. That's November Victor Delta Alpha, and it does have earnings on Wednesday before the market opens. That's a fun one. I like NVIDIA. It's a fun stock to trade. It tends to respond pretty well to the technicals, has decent volatilities, and the dollar is low. It's a good one to, if those of you that are graduates, maybe if you're into this sort of into the tech sector, it might be a nice one to consider because it's very callerable is what I'm trying to say. So I'm in and out of NVIDIA a lot. So usually I get called. I get it put to you by selling puts against it, and then short calls, I'll have my stock pulled away from me. So earnings this week should be interesting. We'll see what happens with NVIDIA. And my third stock to watch this week is Der SPY. That is the S&P 500 ETF, the Spiders ETF. This Sierra Papa Yankee, SPY, is the symbol for that. That better be on everybody's watch list. If not the SPY, then the SPX is certainly a reasonable proxy. You can't actually get shares of the SPX, but you can get shares of the SPY. You can buy shares. Interesting, we talk about this a lot. There are some very major levels of support and resistance. This upper level support that Jeff just happens to have in here is a 2008 was the last time that we were above this. I think May 19th, 2008. That's a long time. So I would expect a significant level of resistance. Slightly below that, somewhere around 141, and then again right around 142-ish, that there'll be resistance. This channeling, this motion that we've had, this up and down, up and down, up and down, I suspect we'll probably stay in this channel at least for the next couple weeks. And so I did an animal trade this week today. When my trades are on the weeks of the job report, I wait until after the jobs report to trade. So after the jobs report, I put in an animal trade. So those of you that subscribe, you should go check it out. And those are the three ones for me. I guess I should mention one other one, and that's JCPenney. I do trade JCPenney. I'm in a collar trade with JCPenney. That's Charlie Papa is the stock symbol. It also has earnings this week. So if you are trading JCPenney, you should probably be considering a collar trade or protecting yourself or whatever position you have. That's it for me, boss.
Okay, I guess I'll go next. Not surprising. I'm going to keep you guys posted. Green Mountain Coffee Roasters had a decent earnings, but what I really liked was the conference call, and that's why I wrote the article that I did. They really seemed to be addressing the issues that Einhorn and Ascherbach, or whatever his name was, and everybody else are pointing out, that some of the patents, two of the patents, are expiring in September that will allow other producers to make their own products, and of course they will come in and try to undercut the price of Green Mountain Coffee Roasters. And so they talked about that. I've always sort of maintained that if you're paying a buck for one of these things already, you've already got the opportunity. If your objective is simply to drop the price, you've already got other coffee products available to you. Why aren't you buying them? You know, when it comes to coffee, and maybe I just like coffee a lot, I don't know, but I know there are a lot of people who do, and it's not, to me, the difference in 20 or 30 cents, or even 50 cents, I'd spend it, and I'll still spend it, so I get what I want, and I get it when I want it, and so I don't think it's as big a threat as they're saying. What I did like is that Green Mountain Coffee Roasters ratcheted down their expectations for sales growth and put it into the 13 to 18, I think, or I forget what the numbers are now, range. So they're being realistic about it, which is a nice change. And they talked about the adoption rates of their Vue brewing system, and I don't think they've done a very good job of advertising it, looking at what the system actually is, and finally investigating it. So you know, they're I don't think they're going to go away yet. I don't, you know, I think they're worth more than what they're currently trading at, but I think it's going to take another one or two quarters before we start to see what the effect is of the no-name brands. And if they are cutting into the market share as much as the bears are saying they are, then the bears are right, and then there will be a significant problem. But, you know, there have been generics offered on everything, and I'd still, if I go to the store, and once a year or so, I got to have Cocoa Puffs. I just really like them. And there's a generic equivalent there, but it doesn't taste the same. I like my coffee strong. All right.
So let me ask you a question. We'll talk about the fundamentals. You solid on the fundamentals now? I mean, you think the valuation is high or low, or what do you think?
At $20-something a share, I think it's low. I think that the PE ratio is now it's up to around 11, which is still below the S&P, and their growth rates are still probably going to be closer to 20%. So, you know, I think it's a little bit low. They've been growing their assets. The CapEx is a little bit high, higher than what it was traditionally, but that's part of, you know, the business plan of expanding some of the lines that they've got. They just got a new contract with Folgers, and I forgot what the other one was. So they're not slowing down, And they have, these are long-term contracts with most of these companies that are non-compete, and they'll be the sole provider. So you're not going to get a Starbucks any other way except through Green Mountain. You're not going to get a Dunkin' Donuts. You're not going to get, it's not Pete's, but Caribou, Newman's, Celestial Seasonings. And I think they're doing the right thing. They're expanding a lot of different products, getting more into cold drinks. They've actually they're starting to introduce a technology that is going to be really good in the commercial space, because as they're going, and I don't want to take all too much time on this, but as there become more and more different types of products, users are not necessarily savvy with how to use the machine. And if the machine can brew a hot beverage or a cold beverage, you don't want to have a situation where the consumer, you know, like you go to a car dealership or a bank or any office and you see one of these machines. You want to have it so that the cup, when it goes into the machine, tells the machine what it is, and the machine then knows what to do. And it's an RF technology that they're going to be putting out soon. And I think that's really going to be something interesting. Patty thinks I married it. Nah, I really like the coffee. Yeah, absolutely. But I'm realistic on the stock. I'm in a collar trade. I added short calls to the position. I do not have short puts on it yet. So we'll see. Golf Mike, Charlie, Romeo. Next up, Cummins. Talked about Cummins a couple of times. And Cummins got pretty beat up at earnings. And actually, there was another pretty big down day. Eric, was that getting my belly?
I don't know. I'm just messing with you.
Eric's just having a really weird thing. Yes, Bob, they do. They can make cold stuff too. Anyway, Cummins is starting to move back up higher. We got some nice technical indications. Cummins tends to do pretty well with the standard crosses or the standard crossovers that we talk about back in level one. I like Cummins. It's a great company. Ticker symbol, Charlie, Mike, India. And the last one, Echo Whiskey Zulu, the ETF for Brazil. It still seems to be basing. We've got a little bit of a bullish trend, but I wouldn't count on it being too much until it gets above 55 or 56 would be even better. Just on my watch list. So, yes, they were, Mitzi. You're right. Anyway, those are my three stocks. And since I talk so much on the Green Mountain Coffee Roasters, I'll shut up and go to Greg.
Eric, I just retweeted you, by the way.
What'd you tweet?
See, that's what you guys don't know that. Eric and I sit while Jeff's talking. We sit and go on Twitter and talk to each other.
And mess around and use the Facebook and send weird pictures to each other. And I try and mess up Jeff while he's talking. I knew he'd look at that picture.
Oh, that's really nasty looking.
It's really bad. Really bad picture. And it's not R-rated. It's just shocking.
All right. My first stock is no surprise this week. Apple has climbed right back out of the hole after their earnings report. In fact, they were only down for one day with earnings, and they started climbing since then. And you know, who knows why? Maybe it's because they have $117 billion in cash. That's probably a big reason why. But there are several rumors floated this week about Apple, one of them being added to the Dow Jones Industrial Average, potentially. They would... likely have to have some type of stock split if that occurred, so that their dividend yield was more in line as to what they want a Dow stock to be. They do pay a dividend. They are the only dividend paying stock in the market that has a market cap of over $200 billion. So it makes a lot of sense to add Apple to the Dow Jones Industrial Average if you're a Dow theorist. If you're a Dow follower, I don't know that it really matters that much to Apple, but the stock split would definitely impact Apple and the number of people who would trade it. Again, I know from talking to many of you and talking from the people I see across the country, they love to say, oh, I'd love to trade Apple, but I don't want to pay $600 a share. I don't want to pay $90 for a leap on this thing. And so they don't trade it, even though they would love to, and a stock split may open up a little more activity. So that's, I believe, one of the rumors that got the stock going this last week. There were some other events that weren't rumors. We got a release date for iPhone 5, September 12th. I know when I will have – actually, I'm not going to have mine until October, because that's when my contract is up on my – cell phone, and it's up for renewal. But I will be going from 4 to 5 sometime in October, and I know there's a lot of other people that are going to be going there right there with me. The upgrade to this new phone, I read yesterday, it is going to be a 4G phone across all systems. So that is one thing that is definitely a downside of the 4 and even the 4S and I believe Verizon and Sprint. I think AT&T is the only one with a 4G phone with the 4S. So there's a good chance that you are going to see a lot of phones sold in the next quarter when iPhone 5 is released. It really does depend on iPhone 5. You know, again, Apple's iPad had a phenomenal quarter. Everything else is firing on all cylinders. They just missed their phone numbers. And the argument that you're hearing come up more and more is this was just a one-quarter glitch, again, where they pushed demand into the next quarter. So speculation has pushed these guys right back up to resistance. I'd love to see them push through 620. They had a nice day today. That, you know, even 2 days ago, they went right up to 620 again. It is a level of resistance that before I would jump in and say it's going to be get uber bullish again, it needs to push through this 620 level. But in the meantime, it's definitely hanging on to support and proving us that this is as solid of a company as you can see. So I'm watching Apple this week to see if they can continue the momentum that they've had. Next one I'm looking at this week is another one of my long-term lookers. I follow these guys, have a position on these guys. They have earnings this week. Monster Beverage Company, Apple Papa Lima. Monster is Mike November Sierra Tango. Again, these guys have earnings this week. Expectations are set pretty high. Expected to come in about 61 cents a share. That represents about a 35% growth rate. So at 61 cents a share, you know, again, this is a stock that's relatively high PE from a standpoint of putting this in the same category as Chipotle Mexican Grill and Panera Bread and Priceline and all the other high-flying favorites. You could see some volatility, and likely will see some volatility in this name this week. So I think they're going to come out with a good report. I'm still in a collar trade, even though I think it's going to be a good report. I'm still collared going through earnings. I think the earnings are on Tuesday, but I'll definitely be watching that one this week and trading that one as well. Last one on my watch, this is actually a new one this week. It's a stock I've known about for quite some time. In fact, I want to say it was about a year ago, maybe not quite a year ago, 6 months ago, on a trip back from Chicago. I actually sat next to a gentleman who was one of the venture capitalist funders who helped take Skullcandy public. He's based there in Chicago, and he was coming out here to Salt Lake. That's where Skullcandy is based, out of Park City. They're a little bit under the radar as far as typically volume that I like to see when I trade a company. However, they just had a very good earnings report, beat on both top line and bottom line. Skullcandy is not a candy company. They make headphones, audio equipment. And again, the earnings report looked pretty solid. So I'm considering, I'm going to start watching this. I'm not going to trade it yet this week, but it is going onto my watch list this week to potentially look at trading opportunities. The volatility is decent in it, so there's an opportunity to trade it, but I always like to add new stocks from time to time, and this is one that I'm throwing on there to start watching. Again, the ticker on this one is Sierra Kilo Umbrella Lima. That's Skullcandy. So those are the stocks I'm looking at this week as well. Jeff, any final thoughts before we wrap it up for the week?
Keep an eye on the news. News, news, news. Eric? Eric, get off of Twitter.
Always have your primary exits and, most importantly, your secondary exits defined. I think that's the most important thing. The other thing is, there's some interesting IPOs next week. Manchester United, I heard they're going public. I think that's going to be fun to watch. But glad to see the IPOs are back. But other than that, be safe, guys, and we'll see you next week.
Thanks, everyone. Have a wonderful rest of your weekend. And we will see you all again, same time, same place next week. Have a great week.